I'm here with Senator Suzanne Chun Oakland and Senator David Ige, and they're going to talk about their top priorities for this legislative session. So, Senator Chun Oakland, maybe you can start.
Sure. Actually, the Senate majority was very supportive of preserving our safety net in health and human services. And so we have two bills, one regarding the rainy day bill, as well as the temporary assistance to needy families bill. In both cases, there's monies that are available. We want to be able to restore some of the health and human service cuts that are being suggested in the budget bill, the state budget bill. And we're hoping that with this and some other sources of funding, we can actually keep families supported with health services, with prevention of child abuse and neglect services, domestic violence, developmental disability types of services, etc. And maybe David can talk about
that. I think
that
the important thing from our perspective is, you know, over the last several years, we've made strategic investments in people. And, you know, we do believe a lot of these safety net programs are really investing in people. We have been working with the congressional delegation to try and stay on top of the economic stimulus package. Congress is talking about significantly increasing the federal support for a lot of these programs. So we want to make sure that, you know, before we shred them, that we have an opportunity to understand what kind of federal help would be, and then we're scouring whatever state resources we have to preserve and reinforce the safety net.
So what programs do you think are in danger of being cut, and how will the Rainy Day Fund and the TANF funds that you're looking at help that?
Right now, what's being proposed in the state budget that was submitted in December to the legislature was mental health services. There was a significant cut. Developmental disabilities types of services, the adult dental, where people would have primary care of their dental needs.
And then the Healthy Start program, you know, we do believe that has been so important to stop the cycle of violence and really give children a chance to really make a go of it.
So do you know how much that you'll need yet from the Rainy Day Fund, and how much is in the Rainy Day Fund? How does that work?
Right now, the Rainy Day Fund has about $76 million, and so we don't want to spend the whole amount, but I think what was proposed is maybe $40 to $60 million the first year, and, you know, $15 to $30 million the second year.
Where does the Rainy Day Fund come from? I wasn't sure.
We actually, when the tobacco settlement occurred nationally, a number of states, including Hawaii, had gotten a tobacco settlement for the next, I think it was 20 plus years. And so what we did was we dedicated a portion of that every year into the Emergency Budget and Reserve Fund. And that's specifically to use for health and human services to preserve safety net when there's economic downturns like this. So we're really happy that it happened.
The other part of the Rainy Day Fund is funded by actually the excess balance. So at the close of the fiscal year, I think it's 5%. So whatever the carryover balance is, 5% gets swept into the Rainy Day Fund. So there's kind of an automatic replenishment. You know, our concern is that we not expend all of it, that we be prudent about it, and that we don't, you know, commit to programs that we can't fund for 2 years. We're very focused on making sure that whatever is funded out of the Rainy Day Fund is sustainable, and then, you know, once we get out of this budget economic downturn, that we would be able to support it with general funds.
There's also money that would be proposed for child care through the Child Care Block Grant, as well as the Federal Medical Assistance Percentage, or what we call FMAP. And both would be very helpful in restoring some of the open doors, for example, child care program that we have, as well as FMAP would help with our hospitals, because a lot of them are really struggling. Our providers are not being reimbursed enough. And so a lot of the health-related services would be able to benefit from that increase in the FMAP percentage.
And what about anything else that you want to talk about in terms of you have an issue about the TANF funds in your plan, in your
the
Senate majority
temporary plan. Assistance for Needy Families program, we basically get $98.9 million in new federal monies every year. And we also were able, through last year's efforts, to have about $75 million in the TANF reserve. That reserve, we want to keep about $40 million in there so that we have at least a year's worth of direct payments to temporary assistance to needy families just in case things get even worse. But we do have excess in that reserve, and so the excess we want to put towards paying direct payments to people on public assistance, thus freeing up more of the 98.9 million new monies for programs that help with prevention of teen pregnancy, employment and training programs to get folks self-sufficient again, and basically to support families so they can stay intact.
Is there any final thoughts that you have or anything you want to ask people in the community to do to support your legislation?
I know the community has actually been very engaged in all of this, and we really appreciate the support and the guidance they've given already. I think many of the folks in our neighborhoods are supporting families as well, you know, personally, and so we really appreciate that.
Yeah, we are really committed to engaging the community to try and make these investment decisions in our people. So, you know, Susie has been the greatest community organizer, just trying to get all stakeholders involved with trying to make some of these tough budget decisions.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Malia.